So children, today are going to start the next chapter, that is metals and non-metals. Before actually going to the chapter, that is what is a metal, what is non-metal, what are the characteristics, how they react, what are the physical and chemical properties, we will first go into the structure of an atom. So what is an atom? Each and every thing in the universe, that is each and every matter in the universe, is made up of very small particles. They are known as atoms. So these metals and non-metals that we are going to read about, they are made up of very small particles. They are known as atoms. So first of all, we will know about the structure. What is an atom? What are the particles that atom consists of? And what are its properties, that we will see. And then we will go into the actual chapter. Okay. So first of all, you can see in the structure of an atom, I have given you a comparative study, that I have compared the structure of atom with the structure of the inner planet in the solar system. You know, all of you know from your geography, that in the solar system there are the planets that revolve around the sun. So sun is at the center, and in imaginary orbits, elliptical orbits, the planets just revolve around. Similarly, in case of atom also, in case of atom, that at the center there is a particle, that is there is a substance that is called nucleus, and around the nucleus there are certain orbits along which the planet like structure that has been called over here as electrons, they revolve around. So what actually the atom is, that is it is consisting of, it is consisting of three main particles, subatomic particles, which are not having any free existence, that is they cannot freely exist. Electron, protons and neutrons, these are the three particles present inside the atom which are not having any free existence. At the center, as has been in place of the sun, if you take the center of the atom, it is having, you can see, it is called nucleus. This nucleus, as you can see, yellow and orange color ball like structure, and on the surface of the yellow color there is a plus is written, and so this plus sign means these particles, yellow color particles, are having positive charge. So these positively charged particles are called protons, protons, and the negatively charged particles, you can see outside, they are called electrons, electrons, electrons. Along with the protons, you can see at the nucleus, you can find some other colored balls like structure. They are known as neutrons. Neutrons does not have any charge. They are neutral in charge. So at the nucleus, what is there? There are two main subparticles are there. What are they? Protons and neutrons. So actually, due to the charge of the proton, the nucleus of an atom is always positively charged. On the other hand, in the imaginary orbit like structure, that is called the energy levels, energy shell, whatever you can call, so those where the electrons are present, these electrons are negatively charged. And for your convenience, it should be known to you that in an atom, the number of protons are equals to the number of electrons. That is why atoms, although having positive charge and negative charge, the atoms are electrically neutral. The charge of one proton is exactly equals to the charge of one electron. Only the sign varies. In case of electron, it is negative charge sign or negative charge. In case of proton, it is positively charged. So atoms, you know, they are electrically neutral. This is the refined structure. You can see the nucleus, the light blue color, is containing the protons and neutrons. Protons have been shown in blue colors and neutrons have been shown in yellow colors. And outside you can see electrons are there. They are revolving in definite energy levels or energy orbits or shells where the electrons are moving. You know, you should know about little bit about the periodic table. Periodic table, you know, in case of periodic table, all the elements that have been discovered till now in the universe, in the world, that has been organized, that has been added to the table according to their increasing number of their atomic number. So what will happen? we will just know about what is atomic number. Just now we have seen that the number of protons, that is, they are equal to the number of electrons. So atomic number is the number, atomic number is equals to the number of, total number of protons that are present in the atomic nucleus. So you may say that the number of electrons equals to number of protons. So why not atomic number is equals to number of electrons? So here we will say that electrons, these electrons are having a tendency to go out of the atom, and some electrons can enter the atom also. As a result, the number of electrons may vary in a chemical reaction. So that is why we just take consider of the number of protons as the atomic number. So what is atomic number? Atomic number is equals to the total number of protons in an atom. Okay. So in the periodic table that I was discussing you about, there are the elements, each and every elements have been arranged in the increasing order of their atomic weight. I have shown you one diagram over here, just so you can see the first one, that is of hydrogen. You know, hydrogen is an element and it is having an atomic number of 1. So what does it mean? It means that at the center of the nucleus, it is having only one proton. So to make the hydrogen atom electrically neutral, there should be one electron in the orbit. So this is the structure, electronic structure of hydrogen. Atomic number 2, which element is there? It is there. It is known as helium and represented by the symbol He. And its atomic number is 2. What is denoting? It is denoting that at the center it is having 2 protons. 2 protons are there. And so to make it electrically neutral, there should be 2 electrons in the outermost shell. You can see that along with 2 protons, there are 2 neutrons also. So what is the function of this neutron? This neutron, what happens when you know those two similar charged bodies, 2 or more similar charged bodies put together, they will repel each other. So to cancel this repelling power, this neutrons are there to bind the protons together. And neutrons also give the mass of the atom. They add up to the mass. The mass of an atom, that is the weight of an atom, is considered as a summation or sum of the number of protons, mass of number of protons and the mass of number of neutrons. Okay. So in case of helium, we can find that there are 2 protons at the center. So similarly, there will be 2 electrons in the outermost orbit. Next, in case of lithium, you can see in lithium, it is having an atomic number 3. Can you see the diagram over here? You can see there are 3. At the center, there will be 3 protons. So electrons also will be there, 3 electrons. This is 1, 2 and 3 electrons are there in the outermost orbit. So what is this rings that I have drawn? These are the energy levels. Okay. So just let me tell you about something, that whenever the electrons are filled in the atom, in the energy levels, they are filled in a definite order. Suppose X is an element and it is the nucleus. Then in the first energy level, the energy shell can accommodate only 2 electrons. In the second shell, it can accommodate only 8 electrons. So it follows a rule, a formula that is called 2n square. So first, this first shell is having the value of n equals to 1. Second shell, the value of n equals to 2. Third shell, the value of n equals to 3. So in the first shell, what will be 2n square? It will be 2 into 1 square, that is 2. In the second shell, what will be 2 into 2 square? That is 8. That is why I have drawn 8 electrons over here. And when n equals to 3, what will be? The number of electrons will be 2 into 2, 3 cube. Okay. 3 cube means 3 square, 3 square, sorry, it will be 2 into 3 square. 3 square means 9, 9 into 2, 18. So in where n equals to 3, the number of electrons that will be getting filled in that energy level, that is 18. So first shell contains 2 electrons, second contains 8, and next it contains 18. So now we are coming back to lithium. So lithium first shell 2 electrons have been filled, so it is enough. It cannot hold more. So the third electron in the lithium will go to the next level. In case of beryllium, you can see beryllium is having atomic number of 4. So there should be 4 protons at the center and 4 electrons. You can see 2 inside, it has filled up the inside shell, and 2 outside. So thus it becomes 4. Boron, similarly, it is having 5. So 5 protons are there and 5 electrons should be there. You can see 2 inside and then 3 in the next level. Similarly, I have shown you the structure of sodium, magnesium and aluminium. Come to right hand side, as I told you in the class that this X is represented by a type element. In this case, chemical symbol, it is a chemical symbol of the element. And what is mass number? Mass number is equals to A, which is equals to Z plus N. Atomic number, what is atomic number? Number of protons, that is of immense importance. Mass number, you should go and read it in the higher classes, that is in the next class, class 9. Similarly, you can see I have given an example of this chemical symbol, that is carbon. Carbon ka atomic number, it is having an atomic number of 6, and it is in having a mass number of 12, that you should learn later on. Just learn about atomic number to see the properties of metals. Okay, so what we can see, that I will tell you about some structures. Okay, before coming to, you have heard about the word sodium chloride, which is known as common salt. You know common salt, and it is given as a symbol of NaCl. So how this compound is formed? Do you know how this compound can be formed? Sodium, you know, sodium is having how many electrons? It is having atomic number 11, so it is having 11 electrons. So in the first orbit it will have 2 electrons, second orbit it will have 8 according to the rule 2n square. Okay, and the third shell, it will consist only one electron. On the other hand, if we take chlorine, chlorine is having atomic number of 17, Cl. It is a symbol of Cl. So first orbit will have 2 electrons, second it will have 8 electrons, and the outermost shell will have 7 electrons, the remaining pops. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. One thing I want to tell you, that for a stable structure of a atom, the outermost orbit should have at least 8 electrons. It should have at least 8 electrons. So you can see in these two structures, electronic configuration, one of sodium and the other of chlorine. Sodium is having only one electron, whereas chlorine is having 7 electrons. So what is it's better? Whether it is better for sodium to give one electron or take 7 electron? It will be better that for sodium to give only one electron instead of taking 7. On the other hand, in case of chlorine, you can see there are the already 7 electrons are there. So it will be better for chlorine to take only one. So what will be the reaction? That this electron that is present in the outermost orbit of sodium will be donated to chlorine. It will donate the electron to chlorine. So chlorine in the outermost shell, now it will have 8 electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. So chlorine will also be stable and sodium will also be stable, because now the outermost shell is this cell, second one, which is already having 8 electrons filled. So it is a stable structure. But regarding the charge, when you just considering the charge of sodium, sodium has lost one electron. So there will be one extra proton in the center. So sodium will be Na positive. That is, one extra proton is there at the center. It will be positively charged. The total element will become a positive one. On the other hand, chlorine has gained one. So we will write it as chlorine minus, means there is one extra electron that has been gained from sodium. This two positively and negatively charged atoms, what are they called? They are known as ions. I-O-N-S, ions. And the positively charged ion is called cation. Negatively charged ion is called anion. So now you know, as like magnet, in case of these ions also, there will be attraction between oppositely charged ions. So this chlorine and sodium ion will come together close and hold themselves very thoroughly, and it will produce the compound that is called sodium chloride. Okay, so this is how the compound sodium chloride is produced by giving and receiving electrons. So what can you see here? You can see sodium is a metal and chlorine is a non-metal. So sodium is, what is having the property? Sodium, the metals are having the property. Here sodium has the property to give electrons. And what about non-metals? Non-metals are having a property to receive or gain electrons. So this is the generalized chemical properties of metals and non-metals. So now we are coming to the definition and the properties of metals and non-metals. So it will be clear, because already I have discussed with you all about the structure of the atom. Now it will be easier for you to understand the definitions. So coming here, metals. What are metals? Metals are described as chemical elements that are generally hard. This is a physical property. Solid, malleable, ductile, possess luster and conduct heat and electricity. These are the physical properties that we are going to discuss in detail next. Next, metals are also described as a chemical element that readily lose electrons. Lose valence electron. Valence electron means the electrons that are present in the outermost orbit of the atom, they are called valence electron. Yes, just now we have seen in case of sodium there is one valence electron, in case of chlorine there is seven valence electrons. So metals can donate, easily lose the electrons. So sodium has lost. So sodium has a metal. So, and this is called a cation. This positively charged ion is called cation. Examples: aluminium, copper, iron, tin, gold. Just now you can add sodium also, potassium also. These are all metals. Around 90 of the 108 elements are metals. So there are 90 metals. Next, non-metals. Non-metals kya hoga? It will be that those elements which do not exhibit all these properties, the physical properties that has been exhibited by the metals. And in the chemical point of view, non-metals are also described as chemical elements that readily they will gain electron. Don't write lose, write here gain. They will readily gain electrons and becomes negative ion, and the negative ion is known as an ion. Here you can see chlorine is a non-metal, and it has gained one electron from sodium and it has become negatively charged, hence it is a non-metal. Example: carbon, boron, chlorine. These are all examples of non-metals. And something you should know, not in much detail, that there are some substances that shows both the properties of metals and non-metals. They are known as metalloids. Next, coming to the physical properties. Physical properties of metals. What are the physical properties? That is, first, the physical state. Hard and they have tensile strength. Solid at room temperature. There is some exception, that is mercury, which is liquid at room temperature. Sonorous, that is the ability to produce ringing sound. That is called sonority, that can be produced by the metal. So this is very important property of metals. Good conductors of heat and electricity. So metals are generally good conductors of heat and electricity. Heat and electricity can easily pass through them. Malleability, it is a property by the virtue of which the metals can be beaten into thin sheets like gold foil, like aluminium foil, like silver foil. The silver foil that we just give on the covering of the sweets, you have ever eaten in kaju barfi, kaju katli and the laddus, pedas, you have seen that the silver foil. So you are just eating silver. Ductility, it is a property by which the metals can be drawn into thin wires. Bahut patle patle wire mein isko dala ja sakta hai, banaya ja sakta. High melting point and boiling point. There is high melting point and boiling point in case of metal. There are some exception like cesium and gallium. they are very dense, that is their density is high, and exceptions are alkali metals because they are very soft and they are less dense. Osmium is having the highest density and lithium is having the lowest density. Metals are again lustrous. What is that? It is having shine. Appearance, metals generally appear silver gray in color, except there are some exception like gold. Gold is yellow in color and copper is reddish in color. Physical properties, what are the physical properties? Physical properties of non-metals are just opposite to that of the metals, because some is they are common that they are solid, they are liquid, and they are present in all three states, that is. And other, they are brittle, they are non-malleable, they are non-ductile, they are not sonorous, they are bad conductors of heat and electricity, although there are some exceptions that we should read. That is, some metals, they are called alkali metals, they are known as sodium, potassium, lithium. They are very soft. That is an exception to the metals. They can be cut into thin wares. Mercury, although being a metal, it is a liquid at normal temperature, room temperature. Lead and mercury, they are, although metal, they are poor conductors of heat. Mercury expands significantly for the slightest change in temperature. They are very sensitive to temperature and they can increase their volume with slightest change in the temperature or heat. Gallium and cesium has a very low melting point, although they are metals. Iodine, which is a non-metal, but it is very shiny, it is having luster. Graphite, although it is a non-metal, it can conduct electricity. It is an exception to the general rule of the non-metals. Next, diamond, although a non-metal, they can conduct heat and has very high melting point. Again, it is an exception to the properties of the non-metals. So for this class, we will just go till the properties, that is physical properties. In the next class, we will be studying about the chemical properties of metals and non-metals. Thank you.